Rochelle?
Hi.
Hi. So we are going to put all the videos on as soon as we go live.
We are live.
It will only be then Upasana and Twinkle. Live. And then we'll turn our cameras off.
So my camera is already off. So do you want me to do anything else?
Let me know when we're ready, then I'll just put mine on and we can.
Yeah, mine's off already. Okay.
Guys, we're streaming live. Hey, good evening, everyone. We're very excited for this chat with Twinkle. And I'm going to ask Upasana to please start the live chat.
Thank you so much, Mansi. A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to this very special Facebook Live for the launch of When I Grow Up, I Want to Be Part 2. We have with us the very wonderful Twinkle Khanna. Welcome, Twinkle. It's lovely to have you here.
Thank you. It's lovely being here.
This book is brought to us by Juggernaut and Tweak India. We have some awesome women here with us today. We have Mansi of Kids Stop Press, Siddhi from Mom Imperfecto, and Sukirti from Sipping Thoughts. And I am Upasana from Gurgaon Moms. So I'll get started right away. Twinkle, do share with us how this book came about.
I think the genesis of this book, it started when we took out our first edition last year. And it came from this feeling that, you know, we had a lot of heroes in the Western world. And we wanted heroes that looked like us, sounded like us, that our children could relate to. And we looked around for all these amazing local heroes that were there. And we wanted the children to be aware of them, to have these different people that they could look up to and different role models. We wanted our children to also see that there were all kinds of variations in families, the way they are put together. I mean, in this one, we included Bibi Kaur because she's a mama who has, I think, 60 children. When she celebrates their birthday, it's with a, you know, some, I think a 10 kg cake or a 50 kg cake or something like that. And I think that for our children to see that there are different kinds of families also that could exist and how you could be marginalized, you could be yourself sort of downtrodden, but you can rise above that and help so many other people. How else would we teach our children this without giving them these role models? And I think that was the idea that started the journey of When I Grow Up, I Want to Be.
That's really wonderful. I did love Bibi Kaur's story. And also the one about the elephant poo paper. That was another favorite. Yeah. So I actually enjoyed Twinkle reading each and every story of this book. And I want to know, is there a story amongst all of these that you discovered?
In this, what I was very keen was to have Perumal Murugan's story because I read an editorial piece about him, which started he was saying how he began where he didn't even have books to read. So he would collect the newspapers that his mom bought back from the bazaar, you know, wrapped with whatever, brinjal and all the vegetables and snacks that come wrapped. So he would trade his snacks with his brother just to get those scraps of newspaper so he could read that. And from there to becoming one of India's most beloved authors is a remarkable journey. And again, it was determination of someone being able to rise above their circumstances. So for me, it was very important to have him included in this book.
That's lovely, Twinkle. Is there anything that, something offbeat that your children do or that you did as a kid?
I think all children have their own idiosyncrasies. I used to keep walking on this raised line of bricks and telling myself stories. That was, you know, I mean, I don't know, maybe other children didn't want to play with me. I don't know why I was doing that, but that was something that I remember doing a lot. And my daughter, she does the same thing. She tells herself stories, but because she's a lot more agile, she skips and she tells herself stories. And this could go on for 45 minutes. And in a way, it's great because she's in her own world. She's actually building her own world while she's skipping. So it's a mental exercise, a physical exercise. And I think that is one of the things that is unusual about her. But also, you know, I feel that that's a good thing.
That's lovely. That's lovely to hear. So we are a community of moms, Twinkle. So I would like to know, is there anything that your mom said that's stuck in your mind for good? While you were growing up?
I think while I was growing up, it was not what she said. It was all the things that she did. And we never had these large conversations. We never had conversations about feminism. We never had conversations about equality. But everything that I saw her doing was along those lines. So sometimes I think we lay a lot of emphasis on talking to our children, but leading by example is very important because they're always watching what we're doing. And I believe there are two ways that you can raise children. You can be like, you can be this complete alcoholic, drug addict, and then you're such an extreme case that children will say, I don't want to grow up to be anything like my parent, or which I don't recommend at all. Or you then have to set the right example by doing exactly what you're asking them to do. So yeah. I think my mother walked the walk, and we didn't have that much talking, but she walked the walk, and I'm trying very hard to follow in the footsteps. I don't know if I'm succeeding, but I'm trying.
What does she think of that? I'm sure that matters.
She will, every time that she thinks I am getting a little above myself, she'll tell me, ki chale ke jhaar pe mat chado. So I think her job is to keep everyone grounded. She's very grounded. And I think that helps keep the whole family sort of pretty much rooted to the level where we've named my daughter Nitara, which means deeply rooted. So I think we're trying very hard to stay with our feet on the ground.
That's absolutely beautiful. So as part of the giveaway, Twinkle, we had a question from our member Priya Lokwani. She says, mm-hmm. while you're growing up, if you're good at multiple things, should you go after everything or should you hone a particular talent? My fears are being a jack of all trades and a master of none. You're such a multi-talented personality and author. Please give us some insights.
Well, what's wrong with being a jack of many trades? You don't have to be a jack of all trades, but you can do multiple things. And if you are, I mean, suppose it's like, if suppose you're 8 on 10 in 5 things, shouldn't you do that? And if you're not really 10 on 10 on one, but that's your talent, to be able to do 5 things splendidly well, compared to someone who can do 1 thing amazingly well. So you have to see what your talents are and what your interests are. Some people do not have such a long attention span. I, for example, I find projects, if I'm writing a book, then I'm writing a book and that's all I'm doing. And then if I'm, you know, working with Tweak, then for 2 years, I won't look up, my head will be there. And then I'll produce a movie and my head will be there. So it depends, you have to know yourself. But while growing up as a child, if your child has multiple interests, then you must nurture all of them because you don't know what is going to be the winning card. And they may have 4 winning cards. Why stifle them and give them only one?
Lovely. I love that answer. Thank you so much for that. I'm now going to hand over to Mansi Zaveri of Kids Stop Press. Hi, Mansi.
Hey, guys. Thank you. Hi, Twinkle. So nice to
hi, Mansi.
Hear all of these conversations. And I'm kind of... you know, kind of thinking that exactly what you said, right? Our moms taught us walk the walk and less talk. I have a question for you, which is, you know, everybody says that you're raising 21st century kids and there's so much pressure, like, okay, there are 60% of the jobs won't exist and all of that. Tell me, what are the skills that you feel that will be needed that will help them build, you know, that have been building like building blocks or bricks for their childhood that you've plowed now?
I think there are two things. One would be resilience and one would be being adaptable.
Yeah.
Because we don't know what's happening every year. And we've just seen that in the last year and a half, the world is changing rapidly in ways that we could never predict. So I think resilience and adaptability, if you have these two traits, and you have to also have, you know, a certain level of education. With these three things within your repertoire, I think you can succeed in multiple fields. And I mean, I went for a college lecture where they were talking about how everyone who's going to graduate in the next couple of years, they have to be prepared to change 8 jobs in their lifetime. And these jobs don't even exist. You cannot predict what they will be. But if you have these abilities, then you can go from field to field because it's a certain skill set that you carry with you where you can grasp the situation and then do your best. So I think I would say resilience, adaptability. Now, how do you inculcate that in your kids? I don't think that there is really an answer, but I think you have to just stop protecting them as much as we all in this generation protect them. I mean, I remember when we were growing up, our parents really didn't know where we were all day. We were outside playing. Nobody really knew. If you had a meal, great. Otherwise, if you didn't, you had your next one. Here, we are constantly worrying about them. Where are they? What are they doing? Are we nourishing their spirit and their mind and their body? I think at some point, you have to just let them be and grow up on their own and take some of those hard knocks.
That's super. Tell me, with the abundance of so much, how are you teaching them the value and importance of things and the importance of being hardworking?
Again, I think hardworking is something that they see that their parents are working. They see that their parents are constantly striving to do better and pursuing their goals. So that's one aspect. About abundance, I want them to constantly feel that this is something that it's a privilege that they've been given. This platform itself is a privilege. And to use it, you can't say, okay, I don't want the platform and throw it away. Nobody is going to give away any sort of privilege they have, whether it is a new phone, whether it is a Frappuccino. But to use that privilege in a way which helps as many people as you can is something that's very necessary. And I think my children at least learn that more from their father than they do from me. I am learning kindness, in fact, from my partner. So I feel that if you have a lot, then you have a lot more to give. And that is something that I try and at least inculcate within, you know, the brains of my kids.
Right. So well said. And the last one, which is in a world where we're seeing kids almost, you know, especially a lot of the city kids being all clones of each other, doing identical things. How do you inculcate, you know, the ability to be original and creative with them? Or in them, rather.
By letting them be. You see them as being clones of each other because they feel that that is the only way they'll get approval. That's the only way they're going to get approval from their parents, from their peers. But what if you make them, you know, really proud of what they already have? And I really try very hard, especially with my younger one, to do that. And to have pride in who she is and what she is, and you know, and not really to put so much stock in appearances, but in your mind, because that's going to stay with you long after, you know, your skin sags and long after you're not young anymore. What are you going to have? Well, you may get Alzheimer's and then lose your mind, but then it wouldn't matter because you won't remember your name anyway. But till then, your mind is what you need to work on. And that's what I think I try and do, at least with my little one.
Right. We see Nitara reading all the time. How have you inculcated that habit of reading?
No, she is rebelling now. She's refusing to read. She's the last 1 month I've been struggling and she's like, no, I'm not going to. We have a pattern of 20 pages a day. Sometimes we reach that target, sometimes we don't. But you know, one page a day also adds up. One page a day, 5 pages another, and really 20 pages one day adds up. Because I think that is one way that they get to experience multiple worlds. And what it really does for them more than anything else is it creates empathy, because in books, they are meeting characters who are so different from them and forming bonds with these characters that empathy then carries on from the fictional world into their reality. And I think that is why I push my kids to read.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Over to you, Upasana.
Thank you, Mansi. We now have Siddhi from Mom Imperfecto. Hi, Siddhi.
Hi, Twinkle. Thank you for this book. It's truly inspirational. Hi. And my question to you is, every child dreams of being somebody while growing up. So, you know, what was your aspiration and how do you feel when you reflect on it now?
When I was very, very young, I wanted to become a scientist. So And then I wanted to become a chartered accountant and a physiotherapist. And I did none of these things. So when I look back, I think maybe I would have been happy working in science. It interests me even today. But the things that I do today are all also part of my childhood. I used to have this diary. Yeah, I used to have a diary where I would write poetry. I had sketches of jewelry, even a three-legged table. Eventually, you know, that's what I've been doing. I've been writing. I've been working in design. And I think my love for reading and my love for words also led me, you know, to forming Tweak and to coming up with books. So whatever we do as children is not wasted. In some way, it really is our core strength. And at some point, it really helps us up our own game.
Mm. And if you could go back in time and, you know, change something about your life, you know, what would that be? So,
I wouldn't change anything. It's all my failures. It's all the difficulties I had. And of course, the privileges I had that have made me the person that I am today. I would not be this person if I didn't have this experience. So some of them were terrible. I mean, yes, I would be very happy if I would not break a bone every year. I mean, it's been, well, let's say, physical and psychological pain, but that made me who I am. Maybe if I wouldn't have broken those bones, I wouldn't be sitting in my bed and reading. I wouldn't be here. So I think that it's best to look forward and to see where you can go from strength to strength rather than going back. That's a futile pursuit, isn't it?
And that's how we learn also from our experiences. Our childhood teaches us a lot, no doubt. Okay, so kids usually end up choosing their parents' profession. An actor's son is pressurized to become an actor, so and so on. So how do you, discuss this with your children, or how do you motivate them to, you know, not to take an independent decision when it comes to their career?
Well, by not imposing your own views on them, by giving them the opportunity, by encouraging them in the things that they are good at. If my son, I feel, is good at design, if he's good at art, I'm going to keep saying, but you know, why aren't you getting an A+ in math? Then I'm doing him a disservice. But by focusing on what he's good at and encouraging him in those things that I can see, I give him the opportunity of making his own career path and choosing his own trajectory.
But with constant peer pressure and competition, don't you feel that, you know, kids, the dreamer instinct in the kids is dying, and, you know, they're not really following their passion. So as a parent, how do you feel, you know, how can we encourage our kids to follow their passion?
I don't think their dreams are dying. In fact, I think it's the opposite. They think that they can achieve their dreams very easily. They're used to instant gratification. I see it in young people. I see it in people who come to work for us. Mm-hmm. They feel the first day on the job, they should know everything, and their boss should say, wow, you're wonderful, instead of working towards it. You know, they think that the real world is like their world of social media, where they must get likes instantly, and you know, people should follow them. And I feel that they have to have dreams and realize that there's a struggle to achieve those dreams. I feel that they're dreaming easy dreams rather than dreams, yes, that they have to work towards. And that is really the issue today.
Yes. Thank you so much, Twinkle. Now I'll hand over to Sukirti from Sipping Thoughts.
Hi, Twinkle. Thank you so much for this really, really lovely book. I read the story today, incredible, to my two little ones. They're 5 and a half. And all day long, they've been asking me, how do they collect now this black soot? So it's fantastic, because at least it made them think. But my bigger question is, you know, we struggle with raising grounded kids. We know we want them to be happy and we want them to be self-motivated. It's the ultimate goal. But still, back in the head, we want them to be successful through the traditional methods that we have been forced into. Yes. Okay, what is the career? What is the salary? What is the job? How do we balance this? Because even though mine are so young, I still struggle with this thought.
I really don't know how to answer that, because I feel that all you can do is give them good values, give them good advice, and then you have to let them be. In terms of wanting them to be successful, yes, it's very important. I think we would be lying to ourselves and being hypocrites if we say that financial success is not relevant. So to guide them into a place where they are able to balance those two things, I think it's a mystery, because if we had succeeded in getting an answer, then everyone we know would have those two things together, personal happiness and, you know, financial stability, and it clearly does not exist. So I think you just have to do your best as a mother, give them good role models around them, get them to read as much as possible, give them a sense of pride in who they are, what they are, and also make them aware of their weaknesses. We hide their weaknesses from them, and then they go into the real world and realize, oh my God. So make them aware that, look, this is what you need to work on. These are your weaknesses. These are your strengths. And then set them off. And you know what? They have to find their own path. That's all we can do as parents. In fact, for us, the lesson is to let go and stop being so controlling about them, because it's their life. And I think that is the answer.
The thing I also loved about your book is the changing definition of a hero. We grew up with Wonder Woman and Superman and Batman, and these were the typical ideas of what we used to think about. But still, this concept of a hero, is it still too much pressure on kids? While it's inspiring, do they feel that they need to achieve too much?
How do they need to achieve? We've got in this book, we had Javed Khan. He's a simple rickshaw driver who, during the pandemic, yes, decided that, you know, his wife said, we'll sell our jewelry and we will take everyone who needs it free to the hospital, you know, for treatment. Now, that is not really a huge goal that we're setting up in terms of ability. It is a goal in terms of empathy. And I think that is the difference. So if we are going to say that there's pressure that you be a more empathetic kid, then I think that is not really a valuable statement. So on the other hand, you have a girl who's won 2 medals, of course, for chess, and she, when she was very young. But again, we're giving a girl a sort of, because chess has always been male dominated, we're giving them options that, look, you can play chess too and you can still be a winner. So I don't think it's a lot of pressure. In fact, we're giving them more possibilities. We're not just saying that these are absolute impossibilities, these are probabilities. And that's what we're offering them, a world of infinite probabilities. So I would not consider that pressure.
Very, very beautifully said. I want to ask you this, because there were, of course, for me being a girl and I have 2 girl childs, of course, all the stories that you did about women absolutely appealed to me. And I know your platform is also all about feminism, but how long will it take to achieve this type of gender equality? Will we see it, at least in the next generation? Will it get better?
I think it's getting better with every generation, but I also feel that the pandemic has clearly revealed that what we thought was gender equality wasn't really, because even when no one could go out to work, it was still the women in the house who were looking after the kids, you know, managing the food, cleaning the house. So there is a long way to go, but we are getting there. And if we look for every generation, we have to educate not just our girls, but our boys as well. We treat them as equals, they will go on and treat the next generation. And finally, I think at some point we will have that absolute equality that we've been working for, you know, for now, I think over 100 years.
My last question, this came from one of our readers, the Snowflake Nightwing. And I think it reminded me of also one of your stories that you wrote about the surfer. Because when it comes to following a passion, we end up not being acknowledged if we are not accomplished in that area. And at the same time, we are stuck by convention. So what would be your take on it? It's when we follow our passion, we do really well, we are acknowledged. But if it doesn't go well for us, you know, people say you should have stuck to the conventional thinking.
I mean, you have to look at, well, if you look at it in a larger way, every failure is an opportunity for you to be able to try something else and to try more. I don't think it's good enough just to say passion is everything. I mean, if you have only passion, then it's a hobby. You have to have passion and the skill set that goes with that passion to make it into a profession. So if you also have to see, what are you good at? It's not enough to be just passionate about something, unless I guess you're doing social work and then your passion is enough, because all you need is a heart. But along with passion, you have to have ability, and you have to judge for yourself whether you have these two things to pursue that one profession. I don't think you have to be disheartened by failure. I've failed multiple times, multiple times. But I feel that I think I failed so often that I forgot to get scared of failing again. It didn't seem to matter. So I was very happy to jump on that table and not worry whether I'm going to fall off again. And I kept doing that. So maybe in a way, failure also makes you thick-skinned and you go on.
No, it's so true. So well said. Getting rid of that fear of failure is so, so important. Back to you, Upasana.
Thank you so much, Sukirti. That was a lovely, lovely, wonderful session. Thank you, Sukirti, Siddhi, and Mansi. We enjoyed having you so much, Twinkle. I just want to mention again that the book is brought to us by Juggernaut and Tweak India, and it's available on Amazon, Flipkart, and in bookstores everywhere. So do go and buy it. I think it's a wonderful, wonderful gift for children. And they're sure to enjoy it, no doubt about it. If not all the stories, they definitely enjoy a couple. If adults like us can enjoy the book, why not the children? And thank you.
No, kids love it.
Yes.
My daughter loves it. I mean, and you know, there are lots of times as moms, I just kind of throw things in. They had to do some weather related non-fictional study, and I said, here's our book, because I didn't have anything else around, and the Iceman, read this and put this into your report. So, and she said, Mom, this is really interesting, and she loved it, and that for me was great validation. So please, kids will also love it. There are lots of illustrations. Please buy this for your kids, and trust me, it's a guarantee that they will really learn a lot from this book.
Yes, definitely. I think they'll be not only inspired, they'll be reassured that you can really do anything in life. I think that's really wonderful. It's always a pleasure to have you, Twinkle. Thank you so very
thank
much
you.
For joining us. Happy
thank you and lovely day
ahead, and thank you all of you who have joined us today. Thank you so much. Do stay safe and buy the book again. Thank you so much, Twinkle.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was lovely being here.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.